Gosh, a lot going on this morning. I can't hardly keep up with it. All right, Numbers 21. As they exit downstairs, let's begin to read here. Let's begin reading in verse number 4. Numbers 21 and verse number 4. This is talking about the children of Israel. The Bible says they journeyed from Mount Hor by the way of the Red Sea to compass the land of Edom. And the soul of the people was much discouraged because of the way. Watch what happens when people get discouraged. And the people spake against God and against Moses. Wherefore have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in this wilderness? That word wherefore means why. Why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there's no bread. Neither is there any water. And our soul loatheth this light bread. That's the manna that was coming down from heaven. And the Lord sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people, and much of the people of Israel died. Therefore the people came to Moses and said, we have sinned, we have spoken against the Lord and against thee. Pray for the Lord that he take away the serpents from us. And Moses prayed for the people. And the Lord said unto Moses, make thee a fiery serpent, and set it upon a pole. And it shall come to pass that everyone that is bitten when he looketh upon it shall live. And Moses made a serpent of brass and put it upon a pole. And it came to pass that if a serpent had bitten any man, when he beheld the serpent of brass, he lived. John chapter 3. John chapter 3, here we're going to compare. Here's the comparison passage. And Jesus said in John chapter 3, verse number 14, a very familiar passage of Scripture, but I wanted you to turn here so you could see the Old Testament and the New Testament are conjoined and go hand in hand. Jesus said in John 3, 14, and as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. Jesus Christ is comparing himself to this same story that we read from Numbers. Let's pray. Father, take the message this morning. Open our hearts, open our minds. Thank you for all that's been done. Thank you for pastor appreciation. Thank you for men of God who stood and proclaimed your word. Thank you for a church who appreciates the word of God. And now I pray that you'd feed us from this precious book. That's why we're here. We're here to be fed. We're here to exalt the Lord Jesus. I pray, Father, that you'd bless now in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. Thank you for standing. Two were on the Damascus Road, and they were talking about the things that had been happening since the cross. And Jesus begins to walk with those two, and he begins to explain, the Bible says. And beginning at Moses, the Bible says that he began to expound to them in the Scriptures all things concerning himself. They were discussing these things, and Jesus discerned what they were discussing, and he told them all things in the Scriptures concerning himself. This is not all things in the Scriptures, but this is all Scriptures. All Scriptures are about Jesus Christ. Somebody said, have you read the four Gospels? Which one of them? There's 66 of them. Amen? And from Genesis to Revelation, there are 66 Gospels. Everything in the Scripture is about Jesus Christ. Bible history is about Jesus Christ. Bible people are types of Jesus Christ. Bible prophecy is about Jesus Christ. The Old Testament told us he was coming. The New Testament showed that he did come. And now the New Testament tells us that he is coming again. This book is about Jesus Christ. If you read this book and you don't meet Jesus Christ, you have failed. If you read this book and become a more moral person, that's good, but it won't save you. If you read this book and learn a code of ethics, that's good, but it won't save you. It takes the Lord Jesus Christ and a personal relationship with him. This book will bring you to Jesus Christ, show you who he is, tell you how to be saved, and you can have an everlasting personal relationship with the God of this Bible through Jesus Christ. First thing I want us to see as we read these verses one at a time again quickly, there was number one, a sinful rebellion. Let's read verse 5 in Numbers chapter number 21, verse 5. And the people spake against Moses, that are speaking against God. They're speaking against God. They speak against Moses. They say, wherefore have you brought us out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no bread, neither is there any water. And our soul loatheth this light bread. That is the manna. So they're hating God. They're hating God's man. And the light bread that they hate was a type of Jesus Christ, which was the manna that would come down from heaven. Jesus said, I am the bread that came down from heaven. So they hate God. They hate Jesus Christ. And they hate, and there is a sinful rebellion against God's man. Number one, they doubted God's promise. The God did not say he was bringing them out of Egypt and taking them into the wilderness to die. No, God said, I'm bringing you out of Egypt to a promised land, a land that flows with milk and honey. Yet somehow they thought that God had just brought them out to die. They failed to believe the promise of God. God has made us the same promise today. If we'll but look to the Lord Jesus Christ, if we'll but come to the cross and repent of our sins, He'll take us to a land, praise God, that flows with milk and honey. Yet why are we like these people when we come to the first problem and we get discouraged? We begin to murmur, we begin to complain, we complain against God, we complain against Christ, and then the next thing you know, we're mad at the church. Too many people today get mad at the church and they're gone. Listen, this Grosses Creek Baptist Church is the most wonderful church I've ever been in, but it's not perfect. The man you're listening to is not perfect. We're here to learn. We're here to grow. We're here to be made like Christ through the reading and teaching of the Word of God. That's our purpose. And so, number one, they doubted God's promise. Number two, they disdained God's provision. As I said before, manna was a type of the Lord Jesus Christ, and they're rebelling against what God is feeding them with. Oh, listen, we ought to be grateful for what God's done for us. I got teary-eyed when they sang this morning, I have been blessed. I've been blessed. Amen. I got up at 6:30 this morning. I was at Cracker Barrel by 8, praise God. Yeah, I've been blessed. Hey, you ever ate one of them country boy breakfasts? I mean 3 eggs and steak and gravy and biscuits and apples. And man, I think I need a nap. I've been blessed. They disdained God's provision. I'm going to bow my head over whatever I've got in my plate and say, thank you, Lord. I've been blessed. Amen. God help us. So they doubted God's promise, they disdained God's provision, and they despised God's prophet. And God said in the Word of God, He said that if people despise you, Jesus said this. He said, blessed are you when men shall revile you and persecute you and say all manner of evil against you falsely for my name's sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for thus they did the prophets. Rejoice and be exceeding glad. Go to bed giddy because somebody persecuted you. That's what he said. So they despised God's prophet. They told Billy Sunday one time, they said, Billy Sunday, Billy Sunday was a preacher. He preached against gambling. He preached against drinking. There wasn't no sin Billy Sunday wouldn't preach against. Billy Kelly was a preacher too, sorry. They said, Billy Sunday, you're rubbing the cat the wrong way. He said, the cat's headed to hell. It needs to turn around, then I'll be rubbing it the right way. Amen. So number one, there's a sinful rebellion here, a sinful rebellion. When you get discouraged, when you get unthankful, hey, you're liable to murmur against God. Amen. You can read the Bible. I think it's only 4 or 5 times that the children of Israel murmured against God, and God took it pretty serious. I'm glad we're under grace, because I've murmured a few times. Have you not? Amen. Let's be honest. Get discouraged. You get discouraged. Discouraged against God. Get discouraged against the Word. Discouraged at church. Next thing you know, you're out in the world. Next thing you know, you're a little deeper in sin. Next thing you know, you need church again. You need the house of God. You need the preaching of the Word. You need the forgiveness of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Been there, done that. So number two, I want us to see this. Verse five was a sinful rebellion. Verse 6 is a sure retribution. You hear me this morning. There's a sure retribution for sin. The Bible says in verse 6, and the Lord sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people, and much people of Israel died. Pretty harsh punishment for people just complaining, right? Seems like it, doesn't it? But I want to tell you something, friend. There's a sure retribution for sin. Be sure, my mama quoted me this so much, I got sick of quoting it, and I hardly ever do. But she quoted this to me practically every time I went out the door. She reminded me of this. She said, be sure your sin will find you out. You say, why don't you quote that? Man, she crammed it down my throat. But you know what I found out? Be sure your chickens will come home to roost. There's a sure retribution. Number one, this serpent. You say, preacher, why does this seem so harsh? Let me give you some things. This was a fitting retribution. The serpent is a symbol of sin. In the Bible, the serpent is a symbol of sin. We've been studying on Wednesday night how you got the serpent, the devil, Satan, the dragon, the Leviathan. They're all the same, and that's a symbol of sin. Brass is a symbol of judgment. And so when Moses puts the serpent on the pole, it's a symbol of sin. It's a symbol of the judgment of sin. Amen. The brass serpent, symbol of the judgment of sin. God is serious about punishing sin. He's serious about it. And the Bible says this, that evil men understand not judgment. So sometimes we think God's judgment's a little harsh. Hell seems a little harsh. Fiery serpents seem a little harsh. But the Bible says evil men understand not judgment. There's something lacking in our understanding when we think God is too harsh on sin. Amen. Yes, sir. I'm in the Word of God now. I'm not preaching one of these little psychological messages. I'm in the Word. Somebody said, "Oh, we ought to preach a positive gospel." Evil men understand not judgment. Let me give an example. If the Supreme Court could vote tomorrow, they'd vote against hell, wouldn't they? Evil men understand not judgment. They have no idea about the judgment of God. See, let me remind you something. God will not let one half of one sin get by. If he did, he would not be God. If he let one half of one sin get by, it would dethrone him from his place on the throne of the universe. Amen. And so, it would diminish his character. It would destroy his integrity. When a guilty man goes free and he's acquitted, even though he's guilty, the judge is the one who is condemned. And nobody can ever condemn God. So number one, this punishment was fitting. Number two, this punishment was fiery. When this fatal fang hit flesh, human flesh, it caused a burning sensation. It was burning. You know, I often feel sorry for a sinner because it pains them to stay in their sin and it pains them to give up their sin. But I'm glad Jesus Christ cleanses from all sin. The grace of God can cleanse all sin, and he can acquit us. Why can God forgive us? Why can God acquit us and let us go on the basis of what Christ has done on the cross of Calvary? Amen. Some people have the idea that God's in heaven making a lot of rules, and we're down here like in a worm in hot ashes, squirming around trying to just obey those laws. That's not true. God is in heaven, and when he says, thou shalt not, he says it because it's going to hurt us. We'd be doing something that would be to our destruction. So God says, don't do it. And let me remind you of something. When you get saved by the Spirit of God, and the Spirit of God comes inside of you, Jesus Christ comes to live on the inside of you, you have the power of God to live a godly life. Amen. God doesn't set the rules up here and then doesn't give you the power to live it. That's what being saved is. Religion says try to live it and doesn't give you the power to do it. That's why there's sex scandals in the church, in the Catholic church today. Let me just call it like it is. Amen. That's why there's no power there to live a godly life. When God saves you and sets the rules here, he gives you the power up here to live that godly life. Amen. So, number one, this judgment is fitting. It is fiery and is also fatal. The Bible says that much people died. Much people died. I didn't say that, God did. You see, the Bible says when lust is conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and when sin is finished, it bringeth forth death. Lust, sin, and death. That's the first LSD you'll find. Lust, sin, and death. LSD. So now let's get to the point of the message. First of all, there's a sinful rebellion. The people rebelled. Then there was a retribution, a sure retribution. The snakes were sent in, but here's what I want to preach. The next thought is there's a saving remedy. There's a saving remedy. Amen. Let's go to verse 7. Therefore the people came to Moses and said, "We have sinned." Oh, I like that confession, don't you? We have sinned. No excuse, no blaming somebody else, no pointing the fingers, no saying, look down there at that, but hey, we have sinned, for we have spoken against the Lord and against thee, praying to the Lord and that he take away the serpents from us. And Moses prayed for the people. There is intercessory prayer. A man told me one time, he said, "George, I don't believe you can pray for somebody. I believe the only person that God will hear is that person praying for themselves." Well, I said, the Bible teaches intercessory prayer, that I can intercede for you and you can intercede for me and we can pray for each other and God hears it. Here is a prime example of Moses praying for the people. And first of all, what you see here, there is a sovereign remedy. There's a sovereign remedy. God said, take a brass serpent. He said, remember now, the serpent's type of sin. Brass is a type of judgment. God said, put it on the pole, and that's going to be a type. We've already read from the New Testament. That's going to be a type of the Lord Jesus Christ. God lifted up the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary and judged him for my sin. The brass serpent. When Jesus, Brother Lord mentioned that just a minute ago. When Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane, why did he pray, "Let this cup pass from me"? You know why he prayed it? He was becoming the snake. You say, "Preacher, that's pretty hard to swallow." That's what he became. He became, listen to what the Bible says. He became sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. He became sin. He became my sin and your sin. He became the snake, and God's brash judgment fell on the Lord Jesus Christ. And when we say that one half of one sin will not go unpunished, I'm glad my sin's under the blood. Amen. And God can say, because of Jesus Christ and what he's done on the cross of Calvary, "George, you can be acquitted and you can go free." Praise God. So number one, there's a sovereign remedy. Number two, it was a sufficient remedy. Everyone that looked lived, no matter where they were bitten. No matter where they were bitten, they lived. No matter how many times they were bitten, they lived. I'm going to tell you something. That's a type of sin biting us. I'm going to tell you something. Every sin, enslaving, bitter, guilt-ridden, sin-stricken, burdened habit can be forgiven in Jesus Christ, and the power of God can be given to overcome it. Amen. And that's what the serpent on the pole is a type of. I say this. They didn't have to climb the pole. Moses didn't say, "I'm going to put a serpent up there, and if you can lift weights and build up and you can climb that pole and touch that serpent, you can be forgiven." And that's not what he said. God said, "Put that serpent up there, and he that looketh can live." You know what that's a type of? Faith. Yeah, all you had to do was believe. If I look up there, I've been bitten, I'm burning, I'm on fire, this was a fiery serpent that bit me, and if I'll just look to that serpent on the pole, I can be healed. You know what you can do this morning? You can look to Jesus Christ. He was lifted up on the cross. We've been bitten by sin, and if we'll but look by faith to him, he can heal us, he can forgive us, he can take the sting of sin away, and the Bible says he's even taken the sting of death away. Thank God. They didn't have to climb the pole. They didn't have to work. The Bible says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Did you hear what the New Testament tells us to do? It says, look to Jesus. The Bible says that it is by faith that it might be by grace. You're saved by faith through grace. Amen. Not of works, lest any man should boast. There was a Civil War soldier dying in the arms of the chaplain. And the chaplain, as a preacher often does, says, son, what can I do for you? He said, preacher, I don't need something done for me. I need someone who can undo some things. And that's what Jesus Christ does for us. He undoes our sin. Thank God. So there was a sufficient remedy. There's a sure remedy. A sure remedy. Can you read anywhere in the Bible where any sinner runs up to the Lord Jesus Christ? And he says, I won't forgive you. I don't read that anywhere. There's a sure remedy in the cross of Calvary. There's a sure remedy in the blood of Jesus Christ. I can't read anywhere. I find one place where the Lord discouraged the Syrophoenician woman, and he told her, he said, it's not meet to take the children's bread and to cast it to the dogs. That's pretty tough. I'll preach on that one of these days. Pretty tough, pretty arrogant of him to say that, wasn't it? And boy, she comes back and she says, yea, Lord, but the dogs eat of the crumbs that fall from the master's table. And he said, daughter, for this thy saying, go thy way. Her prayer was answered. I never read anywhere in the Word of God where Jesus Christ turned anybody away. There's a sure remedy. There's a simple requirement. This was gloriously simple and simply glorious. Let me tell you something. If you ever hear a man preach, and he doesn't preach the gospel simple, so a child can understand that there's salvation in Jesus Christ, there's forgiveness in the blood of Jesus Christ, if he doesn't make it simple enough for you to understand, something is wrong. This gospel is simple. This gospel is by faith. That's what we've already preached, and that's what we'll preach, and that's what we'll continue to preach until the day we die. We've got too much intellect and too much etiquette in the pulpit today. Hey, preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season. Rebuke and exhort with all long suffering. Amen. That's what we need, the preaching of the Word of God. There's a simple requirement. Listen. The Bible says, write it large, so that he that runneth may read. Too many preachers today are trying to be editors instead of newsboys. Amen? God didn't call me to edit this book. He didn't call me to change this book. He called me to preach the word. True preachers will get in the pulpit and preach the word. Amen. We were discussing. I'm going to quote Jeff Cahill this morning. David, you ready for this? We was discussing last Sunday the power of positive thinking, you know. What you get when you turn on the TV evangelist. You get all these positives and negatives. And he said this. He said, a positive attitude will go a long way in this world. And it will. But a positive attitude won't get you nowhere in the next world. I said, praise God, I'm going to make a mental note of that. Jeff Cahill, that's pretty good. How would you like to stand before God and say, Lord, I had the best attitude. I smiled all the time. I preached a positive gospel. God will say, does Jesus Christ live within your heart? Depart from me, you workers of iniquity. I never knew you. And they'll say unto him, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? Have we not done many wonderful works? And he'll say again, I never knew you. Wow. Hey, we better get back to the book. We better get back to the question. What's the question? Are you saved? What's the answer? Jesus Christ. Amen. It's a simple requirement. It was easy. It was essential. See, there was no other way that you could get over this bite other than by looking at the pole, at the serpent on the pole. It was essential that you did that. Let's make some excuses for somebody who won't. Now, can you imagine it? I hope you're getting this message because this was so easy. If you're bitten, you go outside your tent, you look. Simple. You know, the gospel is just so simple. It's so simple that the religions of the world are stumbling over the very gospel that could save them. Wow. Can you imagine some excuses here? Let's look at excuse number one. Well, I may have been bitten, but I'll shake it off. It's burning pretty bad. It's one of them fiery serpents. But it'll be all right. I don't need to look. Hey, that's stupid, isn't it? You know what most people are in this day and time? They're spiritually ignorant, scripturally ignorant. We're dying for a lack of knowledge. What knowledge is that? There's one way to heaven. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by me. Look to Jesus and live. Somebody says, I've been bitten, but I'm not going to look because, you know, I'll just quit my drinking. Well, if you quit your drinking, you'll go to hell sober. Amen. Somebody says, well, I just want to keep my snake. I'm not going to look up there on that pole. I'm not going to look at that brazen serpent. I just want to keep my snake. That's stupid. Amen. People living in sin, dying in sin, their homes destroyed, their lives destroyed, their family destroyed, their finances destroyed, but they want to keep their snake. I say look to the cross and live. Amen. God wants everything for you that'll make you happy, healthy, holy, and humble. We want the first three, but we don't like the last. God wants us to be happy, healthy, and holy. Now, next, the third excuse, and we'll move on. Well, I'll look up there on that pole, and this is the worst excuse I've ever heard from sinners, but you hear it every day. You know, I'll look up there on that pole when I get the healing feeling. Well, if you're bit and you're burning and you're dying, why would you wait for a feeling? Are you listening? What are you waiting on, God? Yeah, well, I'm waiting on, you know, I just got to feel right. Hey, today is the day of salvation, and now is the accepted time. You're sitting in a gospel church under a gospel preacher. Don't tell me Christ isn't dealing with you and the Spirit of God's not convicting you. Hey, friend, today's the day of salvation. Don't wait for bolts from the blue. Come to the Lord Jesus Christ. Confess Him as your Savior. Repent of your sins and you can be saved today. It's that simple. Thank God. And I want you to see this. It was elective. Look at verse 9. How many people can get this? Verse 9. And the Lord said unto Moses, Moses made a serpent of brass, put it up on a pole. Came to pass that if a serpent had bitten, how many people? Any man. There was nobody in the crowd who was bitten by the serpent who couldn't get healed. There's nobody in this crowd this morning who's gone too far, done too much, said too much, murmured too much, complained too much, sinned too much. Hey, there's nobody here. The Bible says any man. This wasn't an election of just a few people. Now, okay, old Joe and Bob and Susie, Mary, they can get in, but no, not over here. There's Larry and Joe. No, sir. This was for any man. I'm glad the gospel goes out to any man. And all you got to do is simple, look to Jesus. Faith. No wonder we say, for the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness. But to us who are saved, it's the power of God unto salvation. The lost man could view the video of Grosses Creek Baptist Church from the camera and say, who is that nut screaming and kicking his feet and waving his arms and preaching about Jesus? How foolish is that? But to us who are saved, who really know what it's like to be forgiven, who really know what it's like to have the power of God, who really know what it's like to live with the leadership of the Holy Spirit, it's the power of God. It confirms in us what we already know. It tells us about our Savior who washes us white as snow. Amen. And so, can you imagine, though, as we close, I can imagine a young man's been bit, and he's in his tent. He's sweating. This was fiery serpents. This caused a fever. This was a sting. And I could just see as his mother would wipe the sweat and pray. And he's dying of this poison that's in his system. And then all of a sudden somebody bursts through the tent and says, don't worry anymore. There's a remedy. Moses has put a bright serpent up on a pole. And all he's got to do is go outside the tent and look. And she runs back in and she takes her son and says, come on, son. All you got to do is look at this serpent and you'll be healed. And he walks out and looks, and all of a sudden the pain's gone. The swelling's gone. The fever's gone. The death sentence is gone. Why? Because he did what God told him to do. Oh, the Lord Jesus is the same. All we got to do is look with all of our heart and live. But now, can you imagine another scenario? And I close the message. A man is in his tent and he's bitten. And somebody says, Moses, there's a serpent on a pole. I hear Moses put it up, and all you got to do is look and live. Oh, I don't believe that theory. I believe the scientific theory of evolution. I don't believe the theory of that. I'll stay in my tent and die. Did you know that's the attitude of a lot of people? I'm not going to, it's, why, Jesus, that's easy. Or, I don't believe that. Hey, as I started off, this is God's way. It's God's way or no way. The preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness. But to us who are saved, it's the power of God and salvation. Amen. Let's all stand. I'm through.